And now it's time for the business of the day. Our first session this afternoon is the age of Trump. The Donald has become quite the world's largest conversation currency, good and bad. And speaking on that phenomenon, our panelists Geraldine Brooks, Mark Kurlansky, Molly Crabapple, Nathaniel Brooks Horwitz, and Talia Kurlansky. The session is moderated by Narayan and Lakshman. May I request them to kindly take the stage and begin the session.
Welcome everyone to this post-lunch session on day one of the Hindu Lit for Life. Hope all of you had a pretty good lunch, but don't doze off. We have a very exciting discussion today for you on the age of Trump. And to bring out the, all the wonderful angles that we can discuss on this amazing topic, we have American writers who've come from a long way off. Mark, you were saying you'd flown in straight from New York. So please give them a warm hand of welcome for coming all this way to talk to us. So there's less than a week as of today before Donald Trump is sworn in as the 45th president of the United States. And of course, it was an election in November that happened, which very few people predicted the outcome of, including the media, including so many ordinary Americans. And yet here we are looking at what could be a complete step change, direction change from the past 8 years that we saw under President Barack Obama. Before we kick off, I just want to very briefly introduce each of our speakers to you. Their more detailed introductions are available on the brochure, and I'd like to save the time available for the actual discussion. So starting, going down the line, first we have Geraldine Brooks, Australian-born, but currently in Massachusetts. Award-winning writer and formerly journalist as well, traveling to many war zones and hotspots, as I understand. And then we have Mark Kurlansky, also a very renowned writer of books for adults and children, some of which he's illustrated himself, I understand. And his special interest is food, and particularly fish and the cod, even more particularly. So welcome, Mark. And very delighted to welcome Talia, Mark's daughter, who is a high school student in New York City. Believe it or not, I think before the age of 12, she, along with Mark, had co-authored her first novel, International Night, right? Which is also about food, and very interestingly, talked about the experimentation with foods from different countries, a little game that they would play once a week or something. Excellent. And then we have here Nathaniel Brooks Horwitz, who is Geraldine's son. Nathaniel is a molecular biologist studying at Harvard University, and he also edits the Harvard Crimson. Thank you for coming all this way, Nathaniel. Appreciate it. And finally, we have, last but not at all the least, Molly Crabapple, who is an artist, an illustrator, a poet. Not a poet? Okay. Well, there's poetry in your heart, I assume. Molly has also traveled to some of the most difficult parts of the world. I believe in West Asia, Guantanamo Bay, all over the world where, we have, which you could definitely call hotspots, war zones. And her art has been described as something that, as art that transcends the guild, the gilded frame of art as traditionally conceived. Let me start by actually posing our first question to Molly. Molly, this is the biggest question, I guess, of the election, which shook the world recently. How, despite making so many statements that were anti-woman, anti-Muslim, anti-immigrant, anti-media, did Trump actually garner so much support across so many different types of people in so many different states? Do you think his emergence was a kind of a trigger for was triggered by, you know, a sort of a deeper process, something that was bubbling underneath, and it was just triggered by this election?
First off, I'd like to say I enjoy how all of the Americans are here together on the stage to explain our national pathology. What's wrong with us? So Trump, why do people support Trump? Before I get into this, I want to start by saying something that's true, but something that's often not mentioned, which is that Trump lost by 3 million votes. 3 million more people voted for Hillary Clinton than voted for Donald Trump. Now, you might ask, if you're not familiar with the intricacies of American electoral politics, how did a man who lost by 3 million votes end up being president? And that's because we have the Electoral College, which is a system that gives certain states, rural states usually, states that were formerly slave states, it gives them electoral votes, and they get more electoral votes than the densely populated cities. So you can win a massive 3 million strong popular victory, but if the people who are voting for you are in cities, it doesn't matter. So Trump lost the majority of people. What he did do is he won by a very, very thin margin in three crucial states. Why did he win? There's a few reasons. The first is voter suppression. Over the last 5 years, over the last 10 years, Republicans have been chipping away at people's rights to vote. They've been doing all sorts of laws that are making onerous requirements for ID. They've been turning people away from the polls. In one state, 130,000 people were turned away from the polls. So that's one reason, and that's the reason that makes us feel good about ourselves. But there's something else, too. The good liberal Washington consensus is rotten. It's rotten to the core. It is the people in Washington, both on the Democratic side and on the Republican side, are deeply corrupt people, deeply in the hawk to kleptocracy, and people who have been selling the civil liberties for many years and getting America into stupid, murderous wars that destroyed a number of countries. And everyone knows that now. And it's not that Donald Trump is better, obviously not. He's an odious tangerine fascist who rapes women and says horrifying things about Muslims. No, Donald Trump is the worst. But Donald Trump also doesn't look like a politician. He looks like an odious creamsicle fascist, but not a politician. And when politicians are such a revolting and also bland and dull breed, then people who are angry at politicians will vote for someone who doesn't look like them.
Thank you. And Nathaniel, my next question is for you. We heard so much about how millennials were an important group of voters for President Barack Obama in 2008 and even in 2012. And yet last year, November, their support seemed to fragment between white and non-white voters. At least that's what the post-election statistics suggested. And obviously, the white voters voted in greater numbers for Trump and non-white voters for Clinton. Why do you think this happened? And particularly, do you think that there was something that the millennials as a generation or group grew fearful of? What would you identify as their biggest concern?
Absolutely. Hard act to follow. And first of all, thank you all for coming. The millennial vote change in the 2016 election was notable for a couple different reasons. First of all, there was a great deal of apathy. Many voters in the 18 to 25-year-old range who overwhelmingly supported Barack Obama, it's not that they supported Trump in the 2016 election. In fact, they overwhelmingly supported Clinton. There were simply fewer of them. Many of the most erudite people my age that I've met, many of my classmates at Harvard, many even politically engaged students failed to make it to the polls.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, another interesting component to it was you mentioned the white, non-white split, and that was certainly present, but at the same time, especially in the Rust Belt states, three states in particular that gave Donald Trump the victory, many white working class voters who voted for Obama in both 2008 and 2012 voted for Donald Trump over Hillary Clinton in 2016. So it's not an entirely racial issue. At the same time, also, we talk about how awful Donald Trump has been in terms of his comportment with women, but a majority of white women voted for Donald Trump. Out of all women together, the majority voted for Clinton, but that was definitely a notable racial split.
Okay, there are a couple of points in both your comments that I want to kind of circle back to. Let me move on and Mark, a question to you. Once in an interview, you said that adults have pretty much made up their minds, and you were talking about you know, books on the environment and fish in particular, and you said, adults have pretty much made up their minds. They like you to the extent that you confirm what they already believe. So with Trump and before that, with Brexit happening in the UK, do you think it is inevitable that our generation of adults will eventually build walls around narrow identities and lock ourselves up with, you know, like-minded people? And if so, do you think the US is sort of at the vanguard of this movement or this trend?
Well, at the present moment, I like to think that the US isn't at the vanguard of anything. The quote that you did was in reaction, it was a response to a question of why I write children's books. Because I feel that children really want to know things and you can really influence them and change their minds, whereas adults like what you wrote to the extent to which you're agreeing with what they already believe. Which is why I don't know any Trump supporters. You know, I do think that this is something that will always be ongoing, that the young people will be more open to new ideas than adults and older people. But I don't think that the situation we find ourselves in is particularly a thing about age. You know, I know that the British just insist that this has something to do with Brexit, but really is a totally different thing. The only thing they have in common is that pollsters were surprised in both cases. What's happened in America is, you know, James Madison, who was one of the writers of the Constitution, said that knowledge will always govern ignorance. Just the reverse has now happened. I'm not ready to predict what the result of that is going to be, but we have a government coming into power, which is the largest collection of fools, ignoramuses, thieves, and bigots I've ever seen in one single government.
Thank you.
We'll have to see how that works out.
Okay, my next question to Geraldine. In your previous avatar as a journalist, as I said, you worked in many difficult places across the world. And I'm sure in that time you dealt or you encountered authoritarian leaders, bosses, gangsters, warlords, local tough guys. Just the other day we witnessed what to me seemed like a horrific spectacle of Trump completely lambasting and bulldozing a bunch of hapless journalists who he put in a room in his own sort of on his turf. And to me, that signaled a very ominous portention of what could come in the next 4 years, hopefully not the next 8 years. So my question to you is, can the free press survive Trump or the Trump movement, as he refers to it? And looking beyond the free press, more broadly at questions of just dissent, you know, different thinking, the kind of thinking that writers and authors such as yourselves do, will that all survive this whole wave? And if so, how?
I hope it will not only survive, I hope that we will all be re-energized by the challenges that this is going to present. I think that often thrives most when it is under pressure, under attack. As a journalist, I was always overwhelmed by the courage of artists in places like Iran, people who could have left but who stayed to fight for the soul of their culture, who would find a way to work within whatever onerous and sometimes life-threatening restrictions were placed on them to make work that spoke, that gave a voice to the real society that was trying, that the tyrants and the oppressors were trying to silence. And perhaps we all got a little bit too fat and happy. When I became a journalist, it was still, it could have been described as more of a trade. It was an occupation that was open to kids like me from the lower middle class or the working class. You could go straight from high school and earn your stripes in the newsroom. You didn't have to come from a fancy family with a string of degrees after your name to be a journalist in those days. And I think at that time the press was closer to the people. And then it became a much more elite profession. And I think something was lost in the translation there. Mark quoted Madison. I've been thinking a lot about Jefferson, who was a slave-owning elitist, but he had a view. but he had a view about democracy and the education that was necessary in order to maintain a democratic society. And when I think about what's happened in the U.S., I look at the betrayal of our kids in the schools. The inequity in education across the United States is absolutely appalling. We've just sold out our kids in public schools in great swaths of the country. And I think if you have an uneducated society, then you're going to have a result like we've just seen in this election.
Could I just
Please.
Add something there? Because I think that you've really hit on the heart of the thing. I in an interview I did with the Hindu, I pointed out that you can see the whole root of the problem in the statistic that 49% of Americans don't believe that evolution is true. Right there, a spectacular failure of education.
Okay, thank you. And I'm going to, again, circle back to all your comments. Finally, to Talia, looking to you for a fresh perspective on all of this heavy stuff. You're obviously a thoughtful young American. You've traveled a lot, done loads of fishing and cooking with your dad, focused on ballet, and most amazingly, as I said, you've co-authored a book as well. So it would be really enlightening for all of us to understand how your generation, how you and your friends in school and in your social circles talked about this election and what it means and how you look to the future.
Well, in the circle that I'm in New York City, there aren't many Trump supporters. I think I have personally met two, which is shocking in itself. I do know the day that the results came out, my school, the principal held a special meeting where people could just talk about their feelings. There were, there were tears. People had to go home. There were hugs everywhere. It was a mess. Everyone, even teachers. I had an English teacher who she just stopped class and she said, "I'm so sorry. My generation has just failed yours." It was a pretty depressing day. And I think for weeks afterward, there was sort of a feeling in New York City, at least where I was, that was pretty down. I know that people who were seniors in my school that were just under the voting age were really upset and angry that they didn't get to cast their votes because over the next 4 years, hopefully just 4 years, they're going to have to live under this, and they didn't get a say. They didn't get to cast their vote. And again, the two people that I know that are Trump supporters, it's all of my friends are completely shocked. We don't understand it. It's a separation between people.
Has a sense of understanding sort of increased, or has there been any change in the conversation since November 8th to now?
Yes, I mean, particularly in my school, we are all pretty much not Trump supporters. So we all have really stuck together. Constantly, though, in class discussions, people keep making references to now that we have Trump, and there's, I don't think a day goes by where a mention of Trump isn't somewhere snuck in.
Okay, that's interesting. Thank you. I'm going to circle back then to Molly, and then we'll have more questions and a sort of a general back and forth, after which finally I'll throw it open to questions from the audience. Molly, you mentioned that, in a sense, the reason for Trump's success, despite all of the things he was saying and the things that people said about him, the allegations of sexual assault, for example, his support came from this hatred or this disenchantment of the Washington politician. But do you think that there was, I mean, that almost suggests a rationality behind a lot of the voters, or the majority of the voters. Do you think there was also an element of pure, I don't know, for want of a better word, just hate? Because Trump, in his essence, is a bit of a hateful, or a bit of, he is a hateful candidate. And, you know, that sort of underpins his ability or his penchant for constantly making offensive, abusive remarks to different groups of people. So do you think there was almost something perverse going on in terms of people being attracted to this sort of energy and dynamic? And what does that, if it's true, or if it's, you know, if it is true, what does that say about the American people, where they are now in terms of their collective psyche?
Trump is the white supremacist candidate. Let there be no doubt about that. Trump is a candidate who is supported by white supremacists. He is a candidate who has taken things that were formerly white supremacy dog whistles, and he has instead shouted them and put them in neon and gilded them. Trump is the candidate of racism, and Trump, when he says make America great again, what he means is make America white again. That's just what it is. Trump was able to tap into a lot of things. You know, no resentment is ever pure, right? I'm sure a lot of the people who voted for Hitler were people who were very concerned about inflation and lack of jobs in Weimar Germany. The Trump voters that I've interviewed, it's been a mix of things. It's been one part very real economic grievance, NAFTA with the closure of factories. One part is this ginned up fear, this fear that undocumented Mexicans and Muslims and Black Lives Matter protesters and every other manner of constructed scary other that Fox News tells them is going to get them. This intense, intense fear of people who perhaps, in fact, generally they've never even met. That's something that drives a lot of Trump voters. But the third thing, yeah, you have a lot of people in America who remember when, if you were a white dude in a Rust Belt town, you could get a union job without a college degree, and that job would provide a dignified living, even if it was a tough one. And those days are over, and the mixture of real economic grievance and incredibly toxic, toxic racist entitlement. This idea that, like, I deserve this because I'm a white dude and this is my America and it's been taken away from me because someone somewhere got a little bit more equality and life is a zero-sum game. Those two things totally mixed together. And yes, Trump is a candidate of hate, obviously. Could you imagine any other candidate standing above a mob of people that are beating up Black people and saying that he would pay the bail? And telling people to, you know, knock the hell out of them. This is a man who stands in front of mobs of people that are committing violence, and he tells them that he has their back. Yes, he's the candidate of hate. And, you know, America is a country that was built by slaves, and it's a country that never came to terms with the fact of slavery and with the fact of white supremacy that built it. And I think that you're still seeing the after effects here.
Yeah, please go ahead, Mark.
I'd say there's just something I have to add, something that isn't getting said here, and it just isn't getting said very much in general. Hillary Clinton was a woman, extremely accomplished, intelligent, capable, aggressive, tough, and all of you women here know that if you are a woman like that, you better play it down, because it'll scare men and they won't like you. And that was, you know, Hillary's big problem. That's why suddenly, you know, emails were a huge issue, even though there was absolutely nothing illegal there. It was this, you know, hatred of the idea of a capable, accomplished woman.
It was also the wrong time for her. And believe me, I fully appreciate the vile depths of misogyny that were directed against Hillary Clinton. And there would never be a female Trump. Could you imagine any woman, as mendacious and incompetent and just like a strutting, wrinkly old rapist liar, but a woman? Like, she would never be on the public stage. She wouldn't be allowed to be. So yes, I agree with you. But Hillary Clinton was not just a woman. Hillary Clinton got where she was by being utterly a part of the machine, because she had to be, because how else would a woman have got to then that position? And this was the year where people wanted to throw a Molotov cocktail into the machine. So she was a woman, and she was also the establishment.
True.
I wanted to, you know, really pin down this mythical Trump supporter. I mean, and you know, you said, yeah, we've all keep talking about him. It's like, you know, the ghost of Vanco. It's let's get to the bottom of this. So the Trump supporter, you know, this person who has a little bit of good in them, who votes for rationally for economic reasons against NAFTA, you know, sort of reasonable reasons. Did they actually sit back and think, oh, okay, I've watched all these U.S. debates. I know exactly what Trump is capable of and what he's saying right now, but in my mind, that carries less weight than my desire to have a free market or whatever, a market that actually the opposite of a free market, a market that's protected for American workers. Did he or she actually just sit down and make that calculus? And what does that say about them? I mean, let's not let them get away with this vague conflation of, oh, many decent, good-minded Americans, saw past all of Trump's other remarks and voted for him. Let's please pin it down.
I don't think that it's letting them off the hook to say that people are willing to tolerate horrible things against other people if they think it's going to be in their financial self-interest. I think it's actually a condemnation of selfishness.
But doesn't that make them racist, misogynist? You can't say a rational-minded person, voted mainly for those reasons, but he looked past the other bad stuff about Trump.
Well, if they're not racist or misogynist, they're certainly okay with empowering someone who is and who said that he would do policies. But I think that this is something that's common in many countries. Many people are willing to empower terrible people who will do terrible things to people who are not them because they think it'll benefit them.
So on that note, I also wanted to ask Nathaniel. So you talked about the way the millennials voted and things that changed. I guess one question I had listening to you was this argument that's been put forth since November 8th, which talks about, I think we alluded to this earlier, in the Rust Belt, there has been a sense of jobs disappearing and people not being able to find a union job and so on. So my question to that was, this process of globalization and deindustrialization has been going on for much longer. In fact, even way preceding President Obama, President George W. Bush, it began much earlier. And so why are we seeing this now? And is it a valid explanation?
Right, absolutely. I think that globalization and what you call sort of deindustrialization is definitely playing a greater role now than at any previous moment. And I think that really came to a head over the past 8 years, during which, as Bernie Sanders liked to remind us in America, a huge percentage of all new wealth generated after the 2008 financial crisis went to the top 1% or the top 1% of the 1%. And very little of that trickled down to the rest of the American economy. And to pin down a sort of pragmatic, perhaps non-racist, non-misogynist Trump supporter, you can imagine a young man, they were primarily men, in a Rust Belt state, whose father has been off the job for 5 years, has been sitting at home watching Fox News for 4 hours a night, whose mother has competed for lower wages against a Syrian immigrant at the movie theater where she's making the minimum wage, and you didn't make it to college, so you're now facing a 40, 50 year future where you cannot be a meaningful contributor to society. You may be able to get on disability payroll and eke out a living. And it, well, that has until recently been a viable career option. Now, for example, truck driving is one of the most common forms of employment in more than half of the United States. But companies like Uber and Ford have promised to introduce self-driving cars, starting with trucks, that will completely eliminate this source of employment over the next 5 years. And this is really what I think is the heart of Trump's victory and the apex of the anti-globalization furor, which is that many people, and in the United States, tens of millions, don't see how they're going to survive in a world where the skills that they have or the skills that they are able to develop where those skills can still make you a living.
Okay, so just to kind of see where that logically takes us, so what is that call for the US? Is it a sort of strategy that Trump has been alluding to? He hasn't put forth any blueprints or concrete plans in the public domain, but is it in terms of somehow slapping border taxes on companies that offshore their operations? And in fact, he's succeeded in getting commitments from several big ones that they're going to be scrambling back onto US soil to do it. Or is it something much more fundamental about, you know, you need to see changes in wage levels. You need to, you know, if you want to compete with someone working in Guangzhou who's producing toys for children, you have to, you know, bring those parameters together, the factors of production and how much you're paying them. And similarly, maybe you have to revamp your system of education. I think you were alluding to that as well. Right. So what do you think is a meaningful way for the US to actually achieve that?
Right. I definitely don't think that any of the policies that Trump or his advisors have put forward since the election stand a chance of achieving the goals that his supporters believe. Really, the majority of people who voted for Donald Trump are being scammed. There are those who, like Molly says, are white supremacists, and they're overjoyed. They know what they got, they know what they voted for, and they've won. But again, tens of millions of Americans are thinking that Trump will make America great again. And they're expecting policies like a border tax or a wall on the southern border to stand up to the incontrovertible rate of technological progress. And his policies, or American policies more generally, could be designed to slow that rate of progress, but the machine is in motion and it won't be stopped by something so nation-focused and ultimately inconsequential as higher tariffs on Mexican imports or bringing back 800 jobs to a Michigan car factory. The policies that will succeed in providing sustainable employment and a good life to the majority of Americans in the face of this progress, which will put tens of millions of people out of work in our lifetimes, education is the number one. People need to be able to fill the new roles in their country. One of the highest paying jobs in the United States right now is computer programming. But the computer programming industry, tech companies, cannot find enough students who know how to code. And that is directly a consequence of a failure in the education system. At the same time, we do have to keep in mind that people who are already past the sort of education period of their life, working class people between the ages of 35 and 60, they don't want to go back to school. They want to go back to slinging concrete for three times the minimum wage. And like Molly said, those jobs are not going to return. So one of the major proposals to cure this has been the universal basic income, which has been proposed in and is in some ways in place in Scandinavian companies with some success. But while this has become sort of the savior, the magic bullet that will save us from the fact that tens of millions of people will lack employment, is that a universal basic income does not allow you to contribute to your country, contribute to your world. It limits your potential as a human being, as a contributing member of society. And I really don't think any of us have heard a reasonable proposal for how we're going to get past that.
I would object to when you say that the universal basic income doesn't allow you to contribute. I think that that's a very narrow definition of what contribution is. It reduces contributing to society to wage labor, right? As if it's not contributing to society to raise a child or to take care of a sick parent or to grow food or to do all of the many, many, many things that aren't compensated by wages and that capitalism hasn't traditionally valued. And one argument that I would have for the universal basic income was that these are vital, vital things, and that in many, certainly in many parts of America, there are things that people aren't allowed to do because they have to work so many jobs. And I think that universal basic income would give back people's ability to create decent communities and care for each other, even if capitalism doesn't think that those are important roles.
Could I suggest one other thing? I think when you look at the graph in the growth of income inequality in the United States, you can track it pretty closely with the decline of unions in the United States. And there will still be a need for people to sling concrete. That is not a job you can outsource. You cannot offshore that. There are still needs for those kinds of labor in the United States, but why shouldn't they be fairly remunerated if we can get some income equality back into the system, which was provided by trade unions? Because when you're only selling your sweat, you have to sell it as a group. You have to stand together. And the way that the union movement was white-anted and traduced and blamed and scapegoated until it is no longer really a factor in how wages are set, I think is one of the reasons that we have the ludicrous 1% of the 1% inequality that we have today. So I think, you know, corporations should be once again forced to pay a workforce fairly.
I agree with that, but you know, there are jobs that are going to disappear. You know, Hillary Clinton went to West Virginia and said, coal mining is dead, you people have to get into something else. Donald Trump went there and said, we're going to reopen the coal mines. Trump carried West Virginia. They're not going to reopen the coal mines. Guess why? Because there isn't an energy company in the world that's interested in coal anymore. So, you know, people are frustrated. They have to learn how to move on. But I just want to say, because, you know, I keep hearing this stuff, and I just, as the descendant of people who were murdered in the Holocaust, I just feel I should say that, you know, you're losing your job, you don't have a good income. All right, that does not justify supporting racism, misogyny, bigotry. There is no excuse for it.
Fascism.
Yeah, if I could just carry forward the points that I think Molly and Nathaniel, as well as Geraldine, made. So this decimation of unions that we've seen, in a sense, is a part of this trend of the conservative America rearing its head with ever more strength. And you know, you do see that across all the red states. You're seeing it in the purple states. I guess to me the question is, along with what Nathaniel and you mentioned about the wage income, sort of an equalized basis of wage income, is this after post-Trump, post-November 8th, is this a time for the left or for socialism? You can stick any label that you want on it. Is this a time for rethinking the way, the dynamics of it, the building blocks of it? Because in a sense, what happened, you know, going back on the arc of history, right to the, you know, post-World War II years, is that gradually from a focus on what you could call true socialism, sort of welfarist measures, which reach the most number of people in a society, the left has become increasingly elitist. And that was that was again used by the Trump machine, and is used not just by the Trump machine, but by conservatives across America to sort of undermine what the left stood for. And actually, the left maybe doesn't even stand for that anymore. So is this a time to rethink the left itself? Or
yeah. I would debate your premise very highly that the left has become elitist. I mean, that's really just branding that right-wing people have done. I certainly don't think Fight for 15, which is a campaign to unionize fast food workers and get them a decent wage, is elitist. I don't think Black Lives Matter, you know, a black youth-led campaign to keep police from murdering black men and women on the streets, is a elitist and foo-foo concern. Universities and university kids are really easy targets because they're young and because sometimes they say things that are annoying, but that's not the... Universities and Tumblr are not the extent of the left in America. And the left in America is a vibrant movement that contains, you know, immigrants organizations, it contains churches that are now stepping up to provide sanctuary spaces for undocumented people, it contains unions, it contains all sorts of groups, and I really don't want to cede that ground to right-wing people and to say, oh, you're leftist, you're some sort of foo-foo intellectual, you know, eating foie gras and caring about Dior only. No, that's not true, and it's never been true. And if we open our eyes, we can see who's actually riding in a golden elevator. It's Donald Trump with Nigel Farage. It's not the left.
Yeah, some poor poorly paid adjunct professor who has to... highway it from one university to another to get to a basic wage is hardly an elitist. And yet immediately the anti-intellectual noise that Fox has created and that Trump has amplified makes them into one.
And one thing that I think is so dangerous, and it's dangerous not just in America, it's a part of the worldwide global trend towards these authoritarian fascist and proto-fascist leaders. A trend that we see from America to Turkey,
India,
to Russia, but one to here. But one thing that I think is very important is that what these leaders do is they try to create two stock figures. They create the silent, decent, good majority and the bad, evil, foo-foo other who's sitting in the ivory tower. But the truth is these figures are lies. They're just cardboard cutouts meant to divide people and to justify their own policies.
Yeah. I wanted to say about, I agree with what you're saying in this. Anti-intellectualism is the great disease of American intellectual life. This idea, you know, we're now living in this world in America where, you know, if you think, if you're educated, well, then you should be ignored because you're elite. So, you know, what's going to steer things? People who don't think and aren't educated? You know, I a couple times had the experience of being interviewed by right-wing nuts on Fox. And it's a very weird experience because, I mean, you know, it was almost fun. I killed them, you know? But they seemed weirdly happy. And then I realized that all they wanted to do was expose me as an intellectual.
So, Mark, you actually preempted the question I was going to ask you on anti-intellectualism. So I was saying that there was an American historian, Richard Hofstadter, in 1963, wrote about this in a book called Anti-Intellectualism in American Life. And he wrote that it represented... there was a resentment of the life of the mind and those who are considered to represent it, and a disposition to constantly minimize the value of that life. So far from being a sudden thing that we're even seeing just in the era of Trump, sounds like it's a long-standing phenomenon.
Oh, it is. It's a long-standing phenomenon in America, but you know, these days you're hearing it more out in the open than... You know, I just wonder what's going on when Obama talks about how Democrats have to, you know, stop drinking lattes, and, you know, who cares if they're drinking lattes? Educated, informed people have to give what they have to offer. And, you know, if you dismiss it as elitist, you're just dismissing every hope the country has.
Right. I certainly agree with the comments on the left not being elitist. I think maybe what I was referring to more was the cousin of the left, which is liberalism. And I would sort of counterposition that to fascism in the extreme, but a gradual, there's a spectrum between that. And you know, to me, it sounds like some of this rage and hate in the Rust Belts and elsewhere was a reaction to liberalism being taken over in some senses by the elite. Or do you not think that's happening?
No, I don't. I mean, liberalism is an idea. Ideas are always governed by thinking people. And, you know, as long as you want to call thinking people the elite, then okay, it's the elite.
No, by elite, I meant more the political elite. You know, the people that Molly mentioned, you know, were hated, the Washington consensus.
Well, a lot of that, and this was one of Hillary Clinton's problems, a lot of that goes back to the Clinton years, when Clinton rebuilt the economy in a way that was not good for unions and was good for certain kinds of jobs and not good for other kinds of jobs. And the people who lost out on Clinton were traditional Democrats. So that's had a political impact. A lot of traditional Democrats voted for Trump. But, you know, if you look at things from a historical perspective, we're living in a time much like the late 19th century, when there was also tremendous political upheaval because not only the economy, but the way in which things were done was dramatically changing. I mean, one of the roots of the American Civil War was the distance between agricultural and industrial societies. And the Industrial Revolution caused huge changes and changed what was possible and created tremendous opportunities for some people and destroyed other people. And with the result of tremendous violent political reactions. And we're living in a time like that.
Okay, very interesting. I think lots of interesting ideas thrown up. I had a few more to talk about, including race, which we did touch upon. Justice, because Donald Trump has promised to appoint a new fill the vacancy in the Supreme Court, and that would make the Supreme Court lean conservative, and that could change a huge number of laws and policies in the U.S. And also, I wanted to talk about the corporatization of democracy, but I think in the interest of time, I'm going to throw this open to the audience, so we have nearly 15 minutes. So if you'll please raise your hands, and then stand up, and then introduce yourselves, and whoever has the mic will talk.
I have two questions.
Can you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, I am Sivakami, a writer. First to Mr. Nathaniel Brooks Horwitz, and second to Molly Crabapple. The first question is, when you said the white labor voted for Trump not on racial grounds because you denied the racial overtones in providing employment, but wasn't there an underlying assumption in the election manifesto of Trump that while displacing non-Americans from there, that he would provide employment? Because he didn't spell out any specific area that he would create employment for them. So this is one. So second question is to Molly. You said, because people don't advocate the theory that just because you are a woman, all the women will vote for you. And Hillary didn't expect that also, because she stood for a cause, I agree. But how well she carried herself with like-minded women in the US? Was there any strong women movement, you know, mobilized in her favor? So I wanted to know.
Right, absolutely. Well, I would say there was definitely a huge racial component in Trump's election with regards to labor, and I don't want to convey that is minimized. Like Molly said, when he says make America great again, he really does mean make America white again, because that's what again means in that phrase. When he's talking about the past, he's talking about an America that was predominantly white, where the white male specifically had all of the power, and that nostalgia for that time, and it could be really any time in American history, almost up to the election of Barack Obama, his entire racial campaign was almost a direct backlash to the election of President Obama. And he's almost doing metaphorically what he wants to do on behalf of his supporters, which is remove a non-white employee from their job and hand it back over to a white man.
In terms of the women's movement, every single public feminist in America backed Hillary Clinton, from classic, like legendary names like Gloria Steinem to more modern feminists. The thing is that I don't know how much pull those people have in the swing states that went to Trump. I don't know how much pull that they had in like rural Pennsylvania or Ohio. And I think that that says a lot about the centralization of the media in the cities. It says a lot about how, sort of in the social media age, we preach to our choirs. But yes, absolutely, in the general election, absolutely every single feminist group that I possibly know of backed Hillary Clinton.
Hi, Reshma here. This is actually for Mark. First of all, thank you for writing for children. I think that's a great gift to humankind. An observation that when I go onto Pinterest and I say leader greater than the country, the top 20 posts are memes on Trump, okay? And all I'm searching for is leader greater than the country. Right, so somewhere there is an influence that has hit the social media world where, the algorithms have said that Trump as a leader is greater than the country, which is United States of America. Now the question here is, we know that children, 4 years is a long time in the lifespan of children. They need to be inspired every day. They need to be really told about who should they look up to. And what are you going to do as a writer for children for the next 4 years? You can't just not have them look up to their leader. They have to respect that office.
I'm going to continue doing what I have done, which is try to write books that inform kids, especially about science, about Darwinian biology. I'm currently working on a book about the disappearance of insects and its impact on the biological order. One thing I find about kids, and maybe Tao, you should be talking about this, but I find that kids are very aware of the degradation of the environment. And that they very strongly feel that we have created a huge mess for them. And they're kind of mad about it. And I want to tell them, yeah, you should be mad about it. But also, you need to have the science to understand this. You have people, it's recently come out in the in vetting Trump's proposed Secretary of State, who was the head of ExxonMobil, that ExxonMobil, going back to the 70s, realized that climate change was real and spent an enormous amount of money backing organizations that denied it. Just give kids the information and the tools to fight the fight they have to fight.
Hi, I'm Murali. I'm from St. John's College, Cambridge. I'm just going a bit broader. I mean, beyond the topic of this session, actually, because you're talking about Trump and Hillary, Democrats, Republicans, right, left, and conservatives, liberals, and whatnot. But actually, America being a land which has been like kind of grabbed from Native Americans on top of a huge, massive genocide, which could actually mean from anywhere from 100 million to 300 million dead. And that issue, as a civilization, as a nation, as different groups of people, irrespective of the political creed, has so far not significantly been addressed at all. I mean, what are we as humans in this globe doing here, going country after country and talking about only the present issues of, all these kind of things? Doesn't it look a bit too rich and fake? It does look like that to me. Sorry, thank you.
Anyone want to respond? Mark? Anyone want to respond, Molly?
That was a great comment. Well, concurrent with this whole terrible election, was the indigenous resistance at Standing Rock, where a gas pipeline was rejected by a white community because it's dangerous and polluting, and so they decided to force it onto native-owned land instead. And despite the water cannons, despite the rubber bullets, despite the freezing temperatures, indigenous activists and their supporters held that land, and they forced the company to reroute the pipeline, so we hope. So this actually is something that, at least in domestic news, was addressed a great deal. Trump promised to build a pipeline right through it, and I believe he owns some financial interests in the company, whereas Bernie Sanders went to address the protesters.
Hello, I'm Maureen. Just two voters that I am aware of who voted for Trump. One was because he wanted to ensure his gun collection, and the other one was, we can't have four more years of Obama. So I think Fox News obviously was very effective, so the media must still be alive.
I think we've also not spoken about another reason people voted for Trump, which is very concerning, which is the issue of abortion. I think that in the Hispanic community, there was a significant percentage of people whose interests were much more aligned with democratic values in every other way who voted purely on the abortion issue. And I think of all the fights that we're going to have to fight in the next 4 years, women's reproductive rights will be right at the forefront.
Could you explain why that is? I mean, despite Trump's comments on the wall and so many disparaging statements about Mexicans and Latinos.
I think that for a significant minority of voters, abortion is the single issue on which they vote. And this is, I'm not sure that there is a way to ever win those votes back, because I think, you know, it's a... women's reproductive rights is a non-negotiable issue, and but much of the chatter among the evangelical and even the conservative Catholic vote was the Supreme Court and making sure that an anti-choice judge was appointed to that vacancy.
Final comments. We're pretty much out of time. From any of my panelists, anyone want to touch upon any issue that we maybe didn't touch on?
I have a final quote that I collected. This is from H.L. Mencken, one of the great journalists of the last century. He said, democracy is the theory that the common people know what they want and deserve to get it good and hard.
Thank you. And that's an appropriate note on which to end this. Please give my panelists a very warm hand of thanks. Thank you so much.
That was a fascinating and insightful session. And a big thank you to all the panelists and to the moderator. Ladies and gentlemen, please note that Ms. Geraldine Brooks, Mr. Mark Kurlansky, and Ms. Molly Crabapple will be available for a book signing right now outside the auditorium.